Friends on Campbell before they do a few announcements. On Sunday morning, we have men's Bible study at 9:45. On Monday nights, we have ladies' Bible study at 6 o'clock. There will be this week, we'll never even know Bible study this week. No Bible study tomorrow night, Labor Day. Wednesday night, we have church 6:30. Thursday night at 6:30, David has Bible study for anybody that wants to come at 6:30. And so long taking place in the church, we're just getting involved. Next Sunday, they're going to start archery. It's from 2 o'clock to 5 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, excuse me. 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock, and it's for what age? Any age. So if your kids want to do that, or maybe adults want to do that, Cecil and Missy are over that, and they've got to set up at the school, and I guess that's where they kind of like it. So next Sunday, we will go up to the building and, up here where we have the school, and they'll have a party together, 2 to 4, and they'll make sure nobody shoots each other. So you won't have to worry. They'll make sure that nobody gets hit in the head or anything like that. But excited about this ministry that's starting. And this is not only for our church. If you know people that want it from other churches, tell them to be there Sunday from 2 to 4. 2 to 4 o'clock. So don't forget that. Remember that. Church tonight at 6 o'clock. Brother Freddie Terry's going to be preaching for us. Excited about what God's going to do here tonight. So don't forget that. Tonight at 6 o'clock, Brother Freddie Terry's going to be here. So remember that. Brothers, come to the altar now. Let's just worship in our giving as they come and take the time.
Father, just be with each and every one here today.
God, we pray for our nation. God, we pray for our community, Father. Bless the people today, Father. God, we speak blessing on this congregation. God, we speak healing. God, we speak salvation. Father, we speak deliverance. God, whatever the need is, God, we know in the name of Jesus Christ, you can do it all. We ask you today, Father, just to bless everyone in here, Father. Bless us all from around the sea. Bless your people, Father. Give you our praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's so good to see Jace Kabushi this morning. I'll pray in him this morning and sing out of your praises. Come on, give her a hand.
God to just bring that healing. Abraham wants to do that. His will to be done. And I ask you just to pray for Jason and his wife. They need to touch. His boy's 10 years old. And so I know that God can just, he can heal him. He can raise him right up. I want us to pray that the Lord just strengthen them and strengthen that family.
Amen. Let's do them together. Father, we come to you for Jacob. For Jacob calls today. You're aware of him. God, I know that he's lived longer than they expected him to, but God, we know he's in your hands. And God, we know that you have the final say. So I pray, God, that you would, Lord, that your will would be done in his life. Lord, for Jason and God, our family, we want your will to be done, God, in this situation. God, we still know you're the healer. And in either way, God, that you're going to touch him, one way or the other. So God, we're just going to trust and believe you today to raise him up.
Thank you. you hear a big amen. Y'all still not believing me today. God is still going to bring it to pass. God has done things this last year.
Come on. Yes,
it is. This past year, God has done some miracles in this place. In the lives of some of you are sitting here. This is, and here's the thing. After all the, you know, the new people come in, Corky and all the other Corkies, and they all come in, and things are happening, and we kind of get settled into this place. You know what I'm saying? We're really excited for a while, then we kind of get into this comfort place. Well, God's not done with what happened started last September. I said, God's not done with what started last September. I said, God's not done. If we're not doing the job here, if we're done here, we don't have any reason for being here today. Because I don't care about getting old. I don't like looking in the mirror and seeing this old man looking back at me. But what happened to that young fellow? Because time is moving right along. We're still here and you woke up today. So God still has a plan and a promise. And no matter how long you've waited for it or how little time you've waited for it, it's going to happen. There's some things we have to do while we're waiting on the Lord. And the wait I'm talking about is not like just sitting in a waiting room. I'm talking about when we go to a restaurant. How many know most of the time somebody has to wait on us? Unless you just go to McDonald's all the time. But if you go anywhere else, mostly you'll have a server, a waiter, a waitress that will come and serve you, right? Amen? And the type of service that you have, you know, makes the meal, right? If you have somebody to walk up, well, what do you want? You're going to like, man, let's go somewhere else. Or, well, I hate being here today, but I'll get you whatever you want. We want somebody to wait on us, right? That are happy, that are willing to, you know, you drop a fork and I'll get you another knife. That makes a difference how you're waited on. Can I tell you why we're waiting on the promise? It's important how we wait. If we're sitting there like, shh, I just don't know about this bunch of people. If we have an attitude that's like, I just don't know if it's going to happen or not. I want a nice waitress, nice waiter, don't you? That they like, I don't know if any of them actually like doing it, but you know, evidently some of them do. Right? I want to wait on God. That's, there's some things we have to do while we're waiting on God. So we look in Genesis chapter 18, verse 1. But earlier, Abraham had the promise that his, he could look up and see the stars, and he couldn't count them. He was going to have that many descendants. And then he didn't even have one child at this time. And did I mention that he's different? He's an old man at this time already? Some of you may feel like, well, it's too late for me. If you're breathing this morning and you're here, it's not too late for you. And the Lord, capital L-O-R-D in New King James, capital L-O-R-D, appeared to him, Abraham, by the terebinth trees of Mamre, as he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day. We can relate to the heat of the day over the last few days, can't we? And he's just sitting here in the tent door in the heat of the day. Some of you are there right now. You're just sitting there in the tent door. I mean, it's the heat. It's the hottest humidity. You're just sitting there waiting. So he lifted his eyes and he looked and behold, three men were standing by him. And when he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and he bowed himself to the ground. Say, he bowed down before them. And he's worshiping them. How many of them? It's very important. Yes. See, it's the Lord appeared to him. I want you to remember that. The Lord appeared to him. So these three men is the Lord. Right? Pretty simple. And he said, verse 3, my Lord, capital L, if I have now found favor in your sight, do not pass on by your servant. Please let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourself under the tree. And I will bring a morsel of bread that you may refresh your hearts. After that, you may pass said, you know the thing about the waitress and the waiter, right? They're just dragging around. No, what is it you drink out of? Glass. Your glass is empty and they just finally come around. You need something to drink? But he hurried to the tent, to Sarah, and said, quickly, make ready 3 measures of fine meal kneaded and make cakes. And Abram ran to the herd, took a tender and good calf, gave it to a young man, and he hastened to prepare it. I want you to know they were getting on it here. So he took butter and milk and the calf which he had prepared, and he set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. Now that's all I was going to read, but I want to read a little bit more. Verse 9, then they said to him, where is Sarah your wife? So he said, here in the tent. And he said, capital H, I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. And behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. Sarah was listening in the tent, which was behind him. I want you to get in the picture. Sarah's inside the tent. She's listening to what the Lord is saying to Abraham. Are you getting the picture? Right? She's hiding in the tent. She's listening to what's happening. He said that she's going to, according to the time of life, she's going to have a son. Verse 11, now Abraham and Sarah were old. Say, they were old.
They were old.
I like this, the way New King James, they were well advanced in age. That's the way I feel. I feel well advanced in age. I'm not really all that old. I'm just well advanced in age. And Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. I want you to know Sarah had already, her time had already passed. She's too old to cut the mustard anymore. She's too old to have children at this point. It's already over. Look at your neighbor and say, it ain't over till it's over. It may look like it's over right now. Things may seem dark and gloomy. You may think, I never knew it was going to get this bad. It ain't over till it's over, right? So Sarah, she's sitting back there thinking, I am way too old for this. She's way past the age of childbearing. Therefore, verse 12, Sarah laughed within herself. She didn't even laugh out loud, but inside she's thinking, yeah, right. You ever done that when you get a word? Yeah, right, I believe that. She's just thinking, here's what she's thinking. She's saying within herself, after I have grown old, shall I have pleasure? My Lord being old also. You can interpret that any way you want to interpret it. My Lord, in other words, Abraham also is an old, dried up man at this time, right? And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah lie, saying, shall I surely bear a child since I am old? He's hearing you. Are you hearing me? You may be back in the tent, but the Lord hearing what you're saying. Why did she lie? And here's what he said, verse 14, is anything too hard for the Lord? Look at your neighbor. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Can I tell you, the Lord can do anything that he wants to do. How many know he still is the healer, right? When we see things happen this week that we wasn't expecting, what you want to happen, but regardless of what happens, he's still the healer. Whether it's here or whether it's there, it's in life everlasting. This is only a temporary thing regardless. If we're 90 years old, if we're 100 years old, how many know it's still temporary? We still are not going to live here forever. Amen? And I'm like, yes, hallelujah, I want to go too. Man, I'd like to win the Blair job this week, honestly. Last Sunday morning, I would like to take out too. Because in that country, there's no more pain. There's no more suffering. There's no more dialysis. There's no more funeral homes. Jim? No more undertaker. I don't mean Jim won't go there. He just won't be under thinking in heaven. No more doctors being doctors in heaven, right? Hallelujah. No more lawyers in heaven. Why? No more electricity. No more light bills. Woo! No more No grocery bill, he said. Because everything's going to work out. Are you here?
Yeah.
Everything is going to work out. Are you here? Everything is going to be okay. And she's laughing within herself, and he said, is anything too hard for the Lord? And then the promise, at the appointed time I will return to you, according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah did not say, I didn't laugh, for she was afraid. And he said, no, but you did laugh. The Lord knows what we say inside the tent. He knows, but some things that happened that Abraham, that I feel like that we need to do, the first thing he said, I want to get some water and wash your feet. And that's what they did in those customs in that time. They didn't have blacktop and pavement, and they walked, and they got dirt and dust and manure and stuff on their feet from the farm and from the animals and all those things. And when they entered into the house, they had a pan of water there, and a servant would wash your feet. Well, here's what I feel like. One of the things we have to do while we're waiting on God, we got to spend time at the feet of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We got to spend time at his feet. You remember reading the story, and I've got it marked up there, how that Mary, she anointed the feet of Jesus. She broke a costly alabaster box, right? That was very expensive, and some say it could have been a whole year's wages. Well, she broke that thing that was so important, and she anointed his feet, and she wept over his feet, and she dried his feet with her hair. She spent time at the feet of Jesus. Mary, Martha's sister, remember Mary? Martha, she's cumbered about. Cumbered about. She's just worried about this. She's fretting about, how's this going to work out? What's going to happen here? God's going to work it out. I said, God's going to work it out. So she, Martha, she's upset. Jesus, Mary won't help me. I mean, I've scrubbed my hands with the bone. I've cooked. I've washed dishes. And Mary just sat there at the feet of Jesus. How many know that's a good thing? Jesus said, Mary showed him this good thing. If you read a little bit earlier in that story, Martha had also, you know, both of them had been at the feet of Jesus. But Martha left her post. And she's trying to get everything together. You ever been like that? There's so much to try to get done and try to get it together that we lose that relationship with the Lord. We got to spend time at the feet of Jesus. Are you hearing me today? We got to spend time in his presence. We're not going to have his peace. We're not going to have, in fact, we can't do his purpose without his presence. I don't know exactly, but in John 20, you remember after Jesus rose from the dead and he comes into the upper room and the door is locked and the disciples are up there scared to death of the Jews, that they're going to come and do the same thing to them that they've done to Jesus. And Jesus walks into the room and the door locked. And the first thing he says, peace be unto you. How many know we got to have peace? And he said, as the Father has sent me, so I'm going to send you. How many know we got to have purpose?
Yes.
We got to have purpose.
Yeah.
And he said, I'm sending you out as the Father has sent me. And then he breathed. I like this there. He, go ahead, breathe on me. I'm not going to do that. I'm rushing there. But he breathed on them and said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. That's the power. How many know we got to have the power? So we got to have his peace and we got to have his purpose. Before we can do any of that, we got to have his power. Amen? Can I get a better amen there? We got to have the power of God in our lives to do his purpose. And we got to have his presence. Amen?
Amen.
We got to have his presence. So he wanted to wash the feet of the Lord. And you know, Jesus did that in John chapter 13, the last night he was on planet Earth. He washed the disciples' feet to show them in humility. That's what we're doing. We're humbling ourselves before him. How many of you old codgers remember when we had feet washing services here at the church? Five of them. And you'd wash the men, would wash the men's feet. The women would wash the women's feet. And a lot of times the men would mostly be over here in this hallway. And you could hear them women just like a bunch of chickens. Woo! Going on and acting up while they were serving one another. They were bowing down before one another. That's what Jesus was showing that picture of what we're supposed to do. So before anything else, we got to spend time at the feet of the King. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Another thing he did, he noticed this, he got a sacrifice. He had the calf killed. You remember that? He went out and killed the calf. And this was way before the Mosaic law came into effect. This is before they offered up sacrifices. And they did all this before any of that. He was showing what God's plan was. I want you to know today, God has a plan.
Yeah.
Things may seem to be out of control in your life, but they're not. And this was the picture of what was going to happen on over in the Old Testament, the sacrifices. But how many knows God just wasn't looking for sacrifices and offerings? Are you hearing me? David, in Psalm 51, verse 16, 17, this is New Living Translation. This is the one part we're preaching that up. He said, you would not be pleased with sacrifices, or I would bring them. If I brought you a burnt offering, you would not accept it. The sacrifice you want is a broken spirit, a broken and repentant heart, oh God, you will not despise. You see what he's after today? You remember about the Saul? Saul got a little bit impatient, and Samuel was coming to offer up the sacrifice, because Samuel was the prophet, and I think was the priest. He was going to offer up the sacrifice. And Saul got impatient. Can I tell you, when we get impatient, bad things happen. So Saul, he goes ahead and offers up. He's the king. He's the first king of Israel. He goes ahead and offers up the sacrifice, but that wasn't what he was supposed to do. While we're waiting on God, we're not just supposed to get up and just do something if God hasn't called us to do it. I mean, you know, you get in trouble when you do that. So he went ahead and offered the sacrifice. Well, this is just a little while later, there comes Samuel. What's this woman I'm here? What is this here? He started, well, the people got impatient. How many know we like me and us up? My wife, maybe. We like to need somebody for an excuse why we did what we did. So, you know, the people, they got impatient. So I went ahead and offered up the sacrifice. And what did God, what did Samuel tell him? To obey. Come on, say it. To obey is better than sacrifice. We can give up and we can quit and we can not have fun and not eat ice cream and drink pop. But that, what God wants is you to obey Him. It's not about all that we give up and all that we sacrifice. Oh, I wore these long sleeves way down to my knees and I'm just so whole. It's not about that at all. It's about, are we obeying what He speaks or not? Because we can be all sacrificial and talk about how much we give up. Lord, I don't rock and roll no more. I don't slap my wife as much as I used to. I mean, we can talk about what all that we give up and everything, but God's looking for somebody that's going to obey Him. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And that's what He's talking about here. Abraham, he's giving us a picture of what was happening under the Mosaic law. And then David and Samuel and all these are letting us know what God is really after. He's after you.
Yeah.
Are you hearing?
Yeah.
He's after you. Paul said in Romans 12, verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you, say you present your bodies a living sacrifice. But quit bonding and crying. A living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. One translation said, this is truly the way to worship Him. How many know that's our reasonable service? That's our act of worship when we offer ourselves. And one other thing I just want to insert here. We're to offer ourselves a living sacrifice. And the sacrifice is on the altar. It all comes back to bread at the altar. It all comes up to dying to ourselves. Can I tell you, in 1 Kings chapter 18, that the fire of God didn't fall until there was something on the altar. Are you hearing? So we're to offer ourselves a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable, which is our worship. In other words, when we're giving our bodies ourselves, we're worshiping God. And that's another thing. We got to do while we're waiting on God. Spend time at His feet. We got to worship Him. Are you hearing me today?
Yes.
How many want to worship Him? In the middle of the storm.
Yes.
Johnny, in the middle of the storm. Now, she put her remarks on Facebook, and it was never like, I don't know what I'm going to do. It was always, I'm trusting God. How many know we got to praise him and worship him in the middle of the storm?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because we don't know what's happening. We honestly don't. We know our life is like a vapor. But what we're obligated to do to reach God's promises in our life, we've got to spend time with his feet. We've got to give ourselves to worship him, to glorify him, whatever's happening. And the way we're going to continue to win people into this place, we're talking a little bit about it in Bible study, the way we're going to win people is if we love God with a fervency and a passion. We're not living like everybody else. Because there are those out there on drugs and alcohol and all kinds of addictions, they're looking for somebody that's different than them. They're looking for somebody that has the answer for the problem. That don't mean we have it all together, but we know where to go, right? We know where to turn. So I want you to realize that the promises that he has given you, while we're waiting on those promises, we're just going to love on him. We're going to worship him. We're going to praise him. Somebody tell me the difference between worship and praise. So we talk about praise and worship. Worship and praise. And it's not just music. In fact, it's not really music at all. Worship comes from an old Anglo-Saxon word, which means worship. Something that's worth something to you. It's what it's talking about. Worship is something that's important to you. It'll cost you something. When those kings came up, you know, when Jesus was like a couple of years old, they offered him what? Frankincense? Myrrh? What else was it? Those were costly things. So instead they bowed down and they worshiped him. And they gave him those things. That's what worship, it'll cost you something. You can't just raising your hands and not worshiping him. In fact, worship comes from bowing down low before him. It was like Abraham bowed down at those angels' feet, at the Lord's feet. He bowed down, he was worshiping them. Praise is exalting his name. Declare what he's done for us. It's bragging on what he has already done. That's what praise is. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Right? Everybody can praise God. Anybody that's got air in their lungs can praise God. Honestly, anybody can. Everything that has breath means everything that has breath. Right? Not just the Christian. Everybody can praise God. But how do you know everybody can worship? Everybody's not going to bow down before him and give their all to him. Give what's important to you that's worth something to you. There's nothing more valuable in my life than my family. You know, that's what's important. That's the only thing I can take to heaven. I can't take my manuals. I can't take my guitars. No, I can't take any money. Can't take my debit card. Can't take my house. Can't take anything at all that we think that is important that we work for all of our life, right, for things. Because Jesus said life don't consist in the abundance of things. It's this, right? That's not our life. What's important is my family, because that's what God gave me. Are you here? They are worth something to me. But more important than anything at all is what Jesus means to me, right? He's the King. He's the one that's coming again. And he's the one that gives us the promise that he's going to do it. And the devil's been telling some of y'all, it ain't going to happen. You're way too old. It should have happened way, way back there. I'm here to declare to you this morning it's going to happen. Hallelujah. So as we witness, another thing to witness, and how many know that's important?
Yes.
On the day of Pentecost, what happened there was all those tribes came from all over, and they heard the disciples witnessing in their language that the disciples didn't even understand. They preached God in their language to all those different languages. So what are they doing on the day of Pentecost? They're just not shouting around and running up and down and speaking in tongues. They're proclaiming and they're praising God and lifting up Jesus Christ. That's what we're supposed to do. Praise him and worship him and be a witness. What did Jesus say after the Holy Ghost comes upon you? Shall be dancers, shouters, runners, witnesses. What's a witness? If you're in the court of law and a witness comes up, what does that mean? I mean, they heard How many's heard? Hallelujah. Come on, talk about the word of God. How many's heard? How many saw God this thing? Right? We're witnesses of Him. Amen. So how many's going to go out this place and in fact, times we will have difficult times. We will. Abraham and Sarah just looking at each other. They're just all wrinkled up. They're just old. I mean, they're just past everything, right? And God said, we're going to have a son. And we'd be just like Sarah. Yeah, right. Can I tell you, God's not done? God's not done. Hallelujah. Say, God's not done. Come on, stand your feet. I'm giving it to Barbara. She's going to be submissive to me this morning. Hallelujah. She's such a good wife. That's my mother. She looks so pretty today. She'll need to help her. She's getting older like Sarah.
Nobody's ready to be submissive. Nobody's ready to all that.
Yeah.
Nobody's ready to say, I want more. Look, whatever your vision has been and wherever it has been, I want you to come as all these others come. And this morning, church, this is what I want.
Precious.
that your life and our life, and that your life in this church and this body, Lord, is worshiping you. We thank you now for the changes that you bring about in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunities that you give us, brother, that you will go with us and keep us safe. Bless each and every one of the families that you represent here.